Computational complexity is a formal area of computer science, which is rooted in rigorous mathematical reasoning. We don't want to just rely on guesses and gut feelings, but we want to build a formal theory which gives us a certain level of certainty. We want to be able to state formal theorems and proofs. To do this, we first need to define what a computational problem is, and then we need to define what a computer really is. And we need formal concepts for these so that we can apply formal reasoning to them. A computational problem is just a function that maps finite length bit strings to finite length bit strings. The idea behind this is that the function indicates for every input that is encoded as a bit string, there is an appropriate output that is encoded as a bit string as well. So we would say if we get some input x, then the appropriate output, if we want to solve this particular problem, is f of x. By now, you will be aware that this restriction to bit strings as inputs and outputs is not a real restriction. We can represent all discrete objects of finite size, like integer numbers, rational numbers, vectors, graphs, and so on, as bit strings using suitable encodings. So for example, we know how to encode integers in a binary encoding scheme. For example, we would have a number like 34 and would represent this as a bit string like 0100010. At times, we may want to distinguish between an object like a graph or a vector or an integer and the encoding of that object. So suppose we have some object x, then sometimes I might explicitly underline that x, which then indicates the bit string representation of x using an agreed encoding. However, a lot of the time we don't want to be so careful about the distinction between the object and the bit representation of the object, so most of the time we will just write x to refer to both. At times we also want to look at pairs of objects or a larger number of objects. So for example, we might want to have two numbers as an input to our problem. So if we want to have numbers x and y as input to our problem, we can encode them in a single bit string. We will write this as x, y put into these angled brackets. So one way of encoding this in a single bit string would be to just take the bit encoding of x and the bit encoding of y and write them next to each other with some separator symbol. Now, of course, we cannot use that separator symbol because we should only use zeros and ones. So what we will do is we will re-encode this whole thing and replace every 0 by 00 and every 1 by 11 and the separator symbol by 01. So for example, if we had two numbers, 34 and 48, then we could encode them as 0011, bunch of zeros, two ones, three zeros, a one, two zeros, four ones, and a bunch more zeros. Now, if you are careful, you can see where the separator symbol here is. It's a zero followed by a one, and it's right there. So now an example for a problem would be that we want to add two integer numbers. So the input would be a pair, x and y, and then the output would be the bit encoding of the sum of x and y. Apart from these general problems where we allow arbitrary bit strings as outputs, we sometimes only really care about what's called a decision problem. A decision problem is a function where the output is just a single bit. It's just a single 0 or 1, a single yes or no. So some inputs have yes as the correct answer, and all the other inputs have no as the correct answer. An example of a problem would be, given an integer x, compute the square of x. An example of a decision problem would be, given a graph g, does g have a Hamiltonian cycle? In the first case, we really need a number as an output, so we need an entire bit string as an output. In the second case, we are only asking a yes or no question, so only a single bit is required as the output. So the first one is a problem, the second one is a decision problem. For reasons which we will discuss much later, a lot of the time it is actually sufficient to consider decision problems. There's an alternative way of thinking about decision problems. We can think about them as sets. Because in a decision problem, all answers lead to either a yes response or a no response. What we can do is we can just group together in a set all of the inputs for which the correct answer is yes. And then everything that's not in that set has a correct answer of no. So for a decision problem F, we can define a set LF to consist of all x for which f of x is equal to 1. This set is called a language. It's called a language because you can think about this set as some sort of giant dictionary that contains all the words of a language. And then we are interested in checking for some given word whether it's contained in the language or not, so whether we can find it in the dictionary or whether it's not included in the dictionary. If the word is part of the language and it's in the dictionary, then we should respond with yes, this is a word in the language. And if the word is not in the language, it's not in the dictionary, it's not in the set, then we should respond with no. So the decision problem here is to decide whether a given input, which is a bit string now, is in our language. When we talk about decision problems, we switch back and forth between function representations and set representations. So we switch back and forth between representing a decision problem as a function that maps to 0, 1, or as a set of words, a set of bit strings. But I cannot emphasize enough that there's no conceptual difference between those two things. A language is exactly the same thing as a decision problem. It's just a different representation. Here's an example. A decision problem might be to determine whether a positive integer is even or not. So the problem would be f of x is equal to 1 if x mod 2 is equal to 0 and is 0 otherwise. The corresponding language describing the same decision problem could be written as LF is equal to the set of all x, where x is a natural number, and x mod 2 is equal to 0.